So some of you just had a flashback to hours and hours of well-invested time playing all sorts of video games. I'm going to move this so I can see you folks over there. We're talking about leveling up. We're talking about the most important thing in all the world, and that is to know God through faith in Jesus Christ. And many people here are in that place. 2 weeks ago, 42 people between all of our services, our nine different gatherings in our different locations, said yes to Jesus Christ. And that's what life is about, because this life is kind of warm up for what comes ahead. And knowing Jesus is what it's all about. And so we're here talking about this, and we're in this series called Level Up. We're using the idea from video games that when something really good happens and you get more strength, you hear something like this. That's the level up. And if things don't go real well, you hear something like this. And we want to go through our days hearing the first of those two options. We want to go through our days being strengthened and empowered. And we talked last week about raising our personal temperature. Looking and saying, honestly, from 1 to 10, I'm like a 1 right now. My heart's kind of cold towards people that don't know Jesus. I kind of try to avoid them. And yet, there's this whole range where your heart can get warmer and warmer. And God, take my temperature up 1 degree and 1 degree. And if you get to the end of the scale, remember I said you can just make a new scale. You add your 11 there, and you just keep on going. But the idea is this. When you've come to meet the living God of the universe through faith in Jesus Christ, when you've come to the cross and your sins have been washed away and your heart's been changed and you found out that you are loved by God, His power fills your heart and your life, and you're changed forever, there's something about wanting to share that with other people, not shove it down their throats. That's why we always talk about organic outreach, natural. But there's ways that God can raise our temperature and increase our passion for people. And that's what we want. So today we're continuing that conversation, and we're talking about not just raising our temperature in general, but specifically raising your passion for people. How do we raise our passion to care about people? We talked last week about four aspects of our eyes. Four aspects of opening up. And the first one was open our eyes. To say, God, open my eyes to see people the way you see them. And then we said, Lord, open my heart to care about people the way you do. We said, open my schedule to make time. And finally, we said the toughest thing, open my mouth, because I want to speak words of life and hope that come from Jesus Christ. Well, today we're going to look at two stories in the Bible that really give us a picture of how Jesus loved people. If you want to learn how to do anything really well, look at how Jesus did it, and then do it like Jesus did. I mean, if you want to learn to do something really, really well, watch Jesus. So if you have your Bibles, turn it to the Gospel of John. We're going to look at two stories. In chapter 3, a story of a guy named Nicodemus. In chapter 4, a story of a woman. We don't even know her name, just a woman by the well. And they would call her the woman by the well because Jesus met her by a well. And we're going to watch. I'm going to ask you to watch. If you have your own Bible and you're turning to John chapter 3, if you have your own Bible, even take some notes in your Bible about what you learned about how Jesus interacted with people, because you want to be like that too. And so we're going to learn. But before we look at John 3 and 4, keep your finger there. Turn over to John chapter 20. And in John 20, verse 30, we read this. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. John says, listen, everything that Jesus did isn't written in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Matter of fact, at one point, John says, if everything Jesus said and did was written down, he said, the world itself couldn't hold all the books. So the point is, you'd need just massive libraries to record everything Jesus did and everything Jesus said over the 33 years of his life. But what God has given us in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, what God has given us in the Gospels are the part of the story of Jesus we need. So that, as John says, these things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life now and forever in the name of Jesus. So the point is that everything Jesus did and said isn't recorded in the Bible, because it'd be a really, really, really long book, and it's pretty long as it is. But the parts we needed, by his Holy Spirit, God inspired those words through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So here's what I want to think about for a minute. So God inspired John to write these words. The Bible tells us that the words of Scripture are breathed by the Holy Spirit of God. Everything in this book is true. And God's given it by his Spirit. So John 3 and John 4, these two chapters right next to each other, have these two stories right by each other. And I thought, why did God inspire John to write these, to record? Why these two stories and why right where they are? Well, I think it's because of this. Because if you look at these two stories, you will learn how to raise your passion and your heart for people. When you look at how Jesus related with Nicodemus and how he related with the woman at the well, how different they were, there's incredible differences and incredible similarities. I want you to notice the differences in the two stories and the similarities and say, God, teach me how to raise my love and my heart and my temperature for people who don't yet know Jesus. So look with me at John chapter 3, this amazing story where he encounters Nicodemus. We'll begin in verse 1 of John chapter 3. And just hear this as a story, as a narrative. I mean, this really happened. Jesus really encountered Nicodemus, and it's recorded for us to kind of look over Nicodemus' shoulder and learn what's going on here. John chapter 3, beginning in verse 1. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus. He was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He's a Pharisee, which means he's a religious leader, and he's part of the Jewish Supreme Court of their day. Educated, bright, very religious. He's a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who's come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him. He had heard and maybe even seen some of the miracles of Jesus. So he says, we know you're a teacher sent from God. Look at verse 3. Jesus replied, very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. If you ever wonder where you get that term born-again Christians, some people use it almost like with those born-again Christians. It's just the line that Jesus used to say, you were born once by your mother, you need to be born again from God and start a new spiritual life. He says, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. Nicodemus responds, how can someone be born when they are old? Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born. Imagine that. He's saying, Nicodemus is a rabbi, and rabbis loved to debate then and now. And so Jesus says, you must be born again. And Nicodemus says, you're not telling me I got to get in my mother's womb and be born again. And he's saying, what are you talking about? And they're having this rabbi conversation, right? Verse 5, Jesus answered, very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water, natural birth, and the spirit, spiritual birth. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the spirit gives birth to the spirit. You need a new kind of birth, a spiritual birth, being born again. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with everyone born of the spirit. Nicodemus says, how can this be? Jesus' response is a little bit tough, but Jesus had to be tough sometimes. He says, you are Israel's teacher. You're a rabbi of Israel. You are Israel's teacher, said Jesus, and you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and we testify to what we have seen. But still, you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak to you of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Jesus only used the term the Son of Man for himself. He says, I came from heaven, I go back to heaven. And he says this. If you know the Old Testament, you'll get this. If you don't, I'll explain it to you. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man, he's talking of himself, must be lifted up that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. In the ancient times of the Jewish people, there was a point where these snakes were coming into the camp and biting and poisoning people. And God said, make this bronze snake, put it on a staff. When people look at that snake, look up to it, they won't be killed. They'll be healed. So it's just like back then that bronze snake could keep people from dying. So Jesus, I must be lifted up on the cross that anyone who looks to me would not die but would live. He says that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him, in the Son of Man, Jesus in himself. Now, at that point, the discussion between Jesus and Nicodemus stops. That's the end of their interaction. That's what we have recorded. That's what God knew we needed to hear of that particular encounter. Next is John talking about that occurrence in the Gospel of John, verse 16. You might have heard this verse before. Maybe you never even knew quite what came before it. But here's what comes next. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only son. This is the verdict. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world. That's Jesus, the light of the world. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light, because their deeds were evil. So this whole encounter, Jesus and Nicodemus, and you watch how he interacted with him, and what you need to know is this: Nicodemus put his faith in Jesus Christ. He gave it as a religious Jewish leader. He saw Jesus as the Messiah and put his faith in Jesus. Matter of fact, after Jesus dies on the cross, Nicodemus is there, caring and involved. He becomes a follower of Jesus. That's John chapter 3. Let's jump to John chapter 4. Let's hear another story, a very different story, but a very similar story. And you'll see, look for the differences, look for the similarities, all right? John chapter 4, beginning in verse 4. Now, he had to go through Samaria. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had been given his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon, middle of the day, hot. This is the desert, hot, hot, hot. Verse 7, when a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into town to buy some food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink?" For Jews do not associate with Samaritans. You may not know all the background, but culturally there was a massive divide. Centuries old, civil war, battle, conflict, religious tension. And in that culture, men didn't talk to women in public almost ever, and a rabbi would never talk to a woman in public. So here's Jesus, and he talks to her, and she says, "How can you, you know, you are a Jew and I'm a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink?" She's confused. Verse 10, Jesus makes it even more confusing. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, if you knew who I really was, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." Jesus, if you knew who I really was, you wouldn't be just blown away that I would ask you for a drink. You would have come to me, a male Jewish rabbi, and you would have said, "Rabbi, will you give me a drink?" If you knew who I was, you would know to come to me and ask, because I'm the source of what you really need. And so she responds in verse 11. "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and the deep is well." She's thinking in practical terms. "Where can you get this living water?" That term living water actually means running water, fresh water. There's water that percolated upward, but there's also water that runs. And if you've ever been like in the Sierra Nevadas, hiking, you're hot, thirsty, sweaty, and there's this beautiful stream, and you put your hands under the rocks where it's pouring down. Have anybody done this? You take that water, there's nothing like it. I don't care. And you just drink. He said, "I want to give you running water, living water, fresh water. Not just this stuff in the well, but running water." And so Jesus says to her, this is what I want to do. "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with. The well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock?" And Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water that I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." If you know Jesus, she says, "If I give you my water," which is himself, he says, "you'll be so filled with this that you'll overflow like a living fountain." He's talking spiritually. She's thinking physically, right? How do you know that? Well, look at the next verse, verse 15. The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He's talking about spiritual transformation. She's thinking water, right? So here, now watch this now. The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." So how does Jesus, she says, "I want this water, give me some water." How does Jesus respond? "Go call your husband and come back." "I want this living water. May I meet your husband?" A strange turn in the conversation, wouldn't you say? But Jesus, again, is getting at something deeper here. "Go call your husband and come back." Verse 17, she says this, "I have no husband. I have no husband." Now, that's only part of the story. But Jesus, because he's God, knew the whole story. He knew her story. And Jesus, and I think Jesus said this with the greatest of tenderness, but truth. You know, you can speak the truth tenderly. I think he spoke this with tenderness and truth. Jesus said to her, "You are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you've had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true." Wow, you think that'd be a conversation stopper, right? But it's not. Verse 19, "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshiped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place we must worship is in Jerusalem." There's a long-term debate about the right place to worship. She wants to get into that debate, but Jesus moves beyond it. Verse 21, "Woman," Jesus replied, "believe me, the time is coming when you will worship, the time is coming when you will worship the Father, neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem." It's not about the place. "You Samaritans," her people, "worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know. For salvation is from the Jews," meaning it comes through the lineage of the Jewish people, meaning it comes through Jesus, right? "For salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming, and now has come, that the true worshipers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is Spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the Spirit and in truth." Now watch this. "The woman said, I know that Messiah, the Christ, the Savior, is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." And Jesus declared, "I, the one speaking to you, am he." You're waiting for the Messiah, the Savior of the world? Jesus says, you're looking at him. Wow. You know what happens? This woman who had been avoiding all the people in her town runs back to town and starts inviting them to come out and meet Jesus. She becomes a follower of Jesus. A bunch of them become followers of Jesus just because of her testimony, and more become followers of Jesus because they come and meet Jesus face to face. Revival breaks out. Two totally different stories, but two very similar stories. And if we look closely at these two stories, we can learn what we most want to know. How can I help people who still need to know that God loves them and that Jesus came for them? How do I let my brother, my sister, my dad, my mom, my cousin, my roommate, my friend, I don't want to offend them. I don't want to push them away, but I want them to know that God loves them. I want them to know Jesus is real. Your heart longs for that. I know it does. If you know Jesus, your heart longs for that. How do I do that? Well, let's watch Jesus. Let's learn from him. Two things are going on here. Some things are contrasting that'll teach us, and some things are the same. So let's look at the contrasting things first. And the contrasting things kind of answers the question of who. Who is it that we should love? Who is it that we should care for? Who is it that we should help come to know Jesus? So here's the first one. Who was Jesus passionate about reaching with his love and his grace? In story number one, Nicodemus, he was trying to reach and bring love to a powerful, religious, Jewish man named Nicodemus. And in story number two, he was trying to reach and bring love to an outcast Samaritan, which was, you know, in their minds, they were kind of a half-breed, ostracized, an outcast Samaritan woman who isn't even named. Who is it that Jesus cares about? Who is it that Jesus loves? It's a Nicodemus, educated, powerful, influential, Supreme Court kind of people, and a woman outcast, unloved, rejected, and self-selecting, I will not interact with people. If she wanted to interact with people, she'd gone to the well early in the morning when it was cool, or in the evening when it started to cool off, not at noon. You come to the well at noon because you don't want to see anybody. Who is Jesus trying to reach? All kinds of people. Here's our lesson. If you're a note taker, in your bulletins there's a place to kind of fill in some blanks and keep notes if you want to. That's there for you. Lesson is this. Jesus cares about everyone, and so should we. Jesus cares about everyone. Some people are like, well, I don't think Jesus, you know, those rich, you know, fancy people with all their stuff, I don't think Jesus, he cares about those people who are wealthy and who've had that experience. Well, the struggling, hurting, outcast, you know, Jesus doesn't really, yes, he cares, and so should you, and so should I. As you walk through your days, as you say, God, raise my temperature, as you say, God, use me to share your love with people, who? Nicodemus and the woman at the well and everybody in between. So be ready, because you're gonna cross the path of people who need to know about Jesus, and you just might be the person God wants to use to share his love and his grace and his truth. A second contrast from these two stories. Who was Jesus passionate about reaching with his love and grace? In story number one, those who initiate and seek him. And story number two, those who are avoiding everybody. Here, these two stories. Here's Nicodemus. He comes looking for Jesus, seeking Jesus. He seeks him out. He says, Rabbi, I've heard about you. I've seen the things you do. I think you're a teacher come from God. I know your story. I want to know more. He was religious, but he hadn't met Jesus yet. And so he came wanting to know more about this Jesus. He knew, he had heard about Jesus. Now the woman, on the other hand, knew nothing about Jesus. She was a Samaritan, different part of the country. Jesus didn't do a lot of teaching or preaching in that area until this time. So she knows nothing about Jesus. So who is it that Jesus reached out to, and who should we reach out to? Here's the lesson. Jesus waits and seeks, and so should we. He waits and he seeks. Sometimes Jesus is just waiting till someone comes. Sometimes Jesus initiates. With Nicodemus, Nicodemus comes to him asking questions. With the woman at the well, Jesus comes to her country, to her place, and he initiates the conversation. So how about us when we're loving people? Should we approach them to talk to them about Jesus, or should we wait till they come to us? Should we initiate or wait till they initiate? The answer is absolutely. That's what we should do. We should wait till the right time, or we should initiate. Well, how do I know? Okay, so my roommate, my friend, this person on my campus, this person in the workplace, how do I know if I should initiate or if I should wait? Don't ask me. I'm a pastor. I'm not, you know, could you knock it off, lighten up on me a little bit? I'm kidding, of course. No, I don't know. Here's the answer. I don't know. But I know this. Every single time, I need to know with a certain person in my life if I should initiate and take that step forward or if I should wait. If I ask God, he always tells me. I can't tell you for your circumstances. I can't tell you about your roommate or your dad or your mom or your friends. But God will tell you if you ask him. Every time Sherry and I go down to visit my dad in Orange County, I pray, Lord, is this a time where I initiate and I bring something up, or is this a time I wait and let him? And every time God puts them, we'll pray as we're driving down. We have like 6 hours, 5 hours to pray as we're driving down there. And we'll pray and we'll talk. We'll say, Lord, what is it? And there's always something God puts on our heart. Sometimes Jesus initiated. Sometimes he waited till people came. And so should we. We learn from Jesus. How do I know which is which? Ask God to speak to your heart through the Holy Spirit. And he will. He'll give you that nudge. He'll give you that. And somebody's going to say, it's time to initiate and take a step forward. And you're going to say, God, do you want to reconsider that? And he's going to say, no, it's time to initiate. You've got to be bold here. And you're going to follow him because you want to be like Jesus and you want to bring his love to other people. Contrast, another contrast. Who was Jesus passionate about reaching with his love and with his grace? Story number one, those who came under the cloak of darkness. And story number two, those hiding in the heat of the day. Here's the lesson. Jesus is ready all the time, and we should be too. All the time. In the Greek language that, which the Gospel of John is written in, when it says that Nicodemus came at night, you could translate it, he came under the cloak of night. He came hidden by night. Because he was a religious leader and part of the Sanhedrin, the Jewish high court, and he didn't really want to be seen at that point checking out Jesus and learning about Jesus. But he wanted to know more. He came under the cloak of night. The woman is there in the heat of the day. Interestingly, they're both hiding. One's hiding at night and one's hiding in the daytime. And you know, all of us, till we know Jesus, we're hiding in some way. And all the people you love and care about that don't know Jesus, they may not know it, but they're hiding in some way. But you know what? Jesus finds us. And we find him in the dark and the daytime. What's the right time to share God's love with somebody? Whenever God opens the door. But be ready. Because this week, if you're saying, God, I'm a two, make me a three. God, I'm a three, make me a four. God, help me love you. You're starting to pray. You're opening your eyes. You're opening your heart. You're opening your schedule. You're ready to open your mouth. You're ready, even if you say, I'm just a three right now, but God, I'm ready if you want to use me as a three. This week, someone's going to come across your path that doesn't know that God loves them. And God's going to nudge your heart to love them, to care for them, to say something, to serve them in some way in the name of Jesus. If you're ready, God's going to use you. Right in your campus, right in your workplace, right in your neighborhood. And if we're all ready and we're all open, man, God is going to touch hearts and God is going to touch lives. One more contrast. Who was Jesus passionate about reaching with his love and his grace? In story number one with Nicodemus, those who know about him. In story number two, those who have no idea who Jesus is. Jesus meets people at any place on their spiritual journey, and so should we. I mean, Jesus meets us anywhere on the journey. When I met Jesus, I knew almost nothing about Jesus. I was almost 16 years old, had almost no knowledge of who Jesus was, but I heard the story of his grace. And I knew very little at that point. I don't think I'd ever even handled the Bible yet. But I came to Jesus. When my wife became a Christian, she knew way more about Jesus than when I did, and she was only 5. That's how little I knew. But she grew up going to Sunday school, and her parents prayed and taught her about Jesus. So who's God going to help us reach out to? Very religious people who seem to know a lot about Jesus, and people who know nothing about Jesus, and everyone in between. You know, and Nicodemus is an interesting story because Nicodemus was extremely religious. He was very spiritual. He just really hadn't met God yet. He knew a lot about God, but God was standing there right in front of him. And he became changed when he came to know Jesus. We have to be ready to care for people anywhere on the spiritual journey. I know nothing about Jesus. I know a lot about Jesus. I just don't believe in him. We meet people right where they are, and we walk with them toward the Savior. Those are all contrasting thoughts. The rest of the thoughts I want to share are consistent. Between the two stories, you see the same thing. And this is mostly about the how. So God puts you in someone's life and you connect with them. How do you reach out to them? How do you care for them? How do you love them? How do you share about who Jesus is? What are some of the things that Jesus did in both circumstances that are good for us to learn from? Here's the first one. How did Jesus connect with people he encountered? Story 1 and 2, both he shocked them. He shocked them. He spoke something bold and shocking. And here's the lesson. Jesus meets people at any, here's the lesson. The message of Jesus is shocking and we shouldn't tone it down. Sometimes his message is shocking and we should be gentle and organic, but we have to say what's true. So in John chapter 3 with Nicodemus, he says, you must be born again. That was a new idea. You've been born once physically, you have to be born. I mean, here's a religious leader. You have to have a new birth, a spiritual birth. Shocking, but true. With the woman at the well, he said, if you knew who I was, you would have asked me and I would have served you living water. Shocking. Unthinkable in that culture at that time. No woman would ask a man in that culture, will you serve? A man she'd never met, a rabbi, will you serve me? She said, if you know who I am, you'd ask me to serve you. Shocking truth. And we should speak the truth of Jesus even when it shocks people. Even when they don't really fully understand what we're talking about, the change he's made in your life, the way he loves. When you say, no, Jesus isn't some religious figure that I talk to when I go to church for an hour a week. He is my closest friend. He's in my life, and he leads me every day. That's shocking. But that's the truth, isn't it? You share the shocking truth of the love and the grace of Jesus. You say, no, you have to understand, I believe that all the wrongs I've ever done and ever will do are washed away because of Jesus. That's shocking. But it's true. I believe I'll be in heaven someday forever because I put my faith in Jesus. Shocking, but it's true. Will you speak the truth even when it's shocking? How did Jesus connect with people he encountered? Another consistent thing from both stories. Story 1 and 2, he talked about spiritual things and he listened to them. Go back and read John 3 and 4. Jesus had these great, rich spiritual conversations. There are a lot of people you will meet who are not Christians, but if you will just listen to them and talk to them about their spiritual journey, they will share with you. So often as Christians, we're busy talking about what we believe. And if you know Jesus, you want to share his goodness. That's great. But also listen to people. I met a woman recently in sort of like in a business setting, and I knew I was going to be around her for a while. So I asked her. I said, hey, what? I grew up in a non-believing home, a non-faith home, and now I'm a pastor. I've got kind of an interesting journey. What was your journey? Do you have a spiritual journey? She just started talking about from the time she was a child till now and told me her whole story. And along the way, she said, I'm not sure if I even believe in God, and I don't really know if I believe in the whole Jesus thing, but this is my story. She shared with me very openly, and I got to know a lot about her. Jesus had these spiritual conversations, and in that conversation, people moved toward him when they saw that he was the truth. And so the lesson is this: listen well, and talk often about your faith. Talk about your faith. Don't force it on people, but talk naturally about what you believe and who you are because of Jesus, and people will respect that. They mostly will respect that. How did Jesus connect with people he encountered? Another consistent thing in stories 1 and 2. He challenged them and spoke hard truth. He took risks. And the lesson is this: dare to speak the truth. Not everyone will agree, but most will respect the fact that you know what you believe and actually believe it. People want to know, do you believe what you say you believe? And Jesus did. I mean, Jesus spoke hard truth. He said to Nicodemus, you're Israel's teacher and you don't understand the basics? He challenged him. He said to the woman at the well, I'd like to meet your husband, because he knew her background and he knew it was out of her brokenness and her longing for love and her longing for something that he knew that she would only be satisfied and stop drinking at all the wrong wells if she came to the living well, and that was Jesus. So he wanted her to talk about what she longed for and didn't have so she could see what she could find in him. But sometimes those truths are challenging. Do you believe what you believe? Can you put it into words? And will you speak the truth gently? I'll tell you a story about a college person who was part of Shoreline Church, working in a retail setting. And this at the time, he was a student at a Christian school. So one of the people he worked with knew that he went to this Christian school. So this person sort of said to him, this person was, you know, not in a place of really believing in Jesus. And they said to this college student, hey, you go to that Christian school, right? And he said, well, yeah, that Christian college. Yeah, I do. So, well, do you really believe all that stuff about, like, you know, people need Jesus to go to heaven? And do you really believe, like, in heaven and believe in hell? Do you really believe all that stuff? And this was a response to her. He said, well, whether I believe it or not doesn't matter. It's true. Leave that hanging out there, right? She says, what do you mean? He says, well, whether I believe in heaven and hell doesn't change the fact that they're real. Heaven and hell are real. And out of that just personal conviction, he wasn't rude or mean. He just said, well, it doesn't matter what I believe when it comes to heaven and hell or Jesus. Jesus is the Savior. Heaven and hell are real because they are. If I don't believe it. It doesn't make it go away. And that led to a conversation with this person who had some kind of faith when she was younger, but in that conversation at that store, she recommitted her heart to Jesus. Because somebody could say, this is what I believe, and I believe it with conviction. Most people will respect if you know what you believe and you stand on it. Some won't, but most will. And so know what you believe and stand on it. He spoke the truth. He dared to do that. How did Jesus connect with people he encountered? Another consistent theme. He spoke to their deepest longings. He spoke to where their hearts most longed. Here's the lesson. Help people see that Jesus meets the greatest yearnings of our hearts. You know what Nicodemus wanted? He had plenty of religion. He wanted to know God. He wanted to meet God. He wanted a relationship, and he found it in Jesus. That was his deepest longing. So Jesus went to that place. You know what the woman wanted? The woman at the well? She didn't want water. She wanted her soul to stop thirsting. She came to the well every day trying to satisfy her thirst, but she went through man after man after man after man trying to satisfy her soul, and she was still empty. And Jesus said, I will give you water that will make you never thirst again. That's what she wanted. When you talk with people who don't know Jesus, can you understand this? All that their heart longs for is found in Jesus. You talk with a friend who says, I'm so lonely. I've gone through all these different relationships. I'm just so lonely and empty. Until they meet Jesus and find the one who loves them, no matter what, they won't be satisfied. Somebody struggling financially, I need to have enough to feel secure. There's people that have millions that don't feel secure. You know why they don't feel secure? Because they're not. Until you know Jesus. And he holds you in his hand. What people long for, Jesus has, and you can share that with them. And then one last similarity between these two stories, one consistent theme. How did Jesus connect the people he encountered? Both stories, he called them to faith and commitment in him. Nicodemus, you must be born again. You've been born of water. It's time to be born of the Spirit. The woman at the well, you're longing and waiting for the Messiah to show you the way home. Jesus says what? You're looking at him. Wow. And the deepest need that your friends and family have, the deepest need they have if they don't know Jesus, is to know the one who made them and who loves them and who gave his life on a cross for them. That's their deepest, and all their greatest longings that follow that will be satisfied in Jesus. They really will. So will you commit to pray with me that we would become those kind of people who see people the way Jesus did and love them and share his story boldly, gently, creatively, talking about spiritual things when the moment is right, opening our eyes and our hearts and our schedules and our mouths when the time is right. Let's ask God to help us do that. Oh God, we come before you today. And we who have put our faith in you, we want other people to know that you love them too. We want that with all of our hearts. We want them to be satisfied in you, to stop going from well to well to well, thirsting for things that never satisfy, but come to you, Jesus. So we say, use us, God. Open our eyes, open our hearts, open our schedules, open our mouths, and let us love people the way you love them and help them walk towards you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.